you're running in your shell, you have to dig through your shell history and hope to God that you had the right thing in there so you could be like, oh, that's what I ran, versus put in the file, run the commands to actually run it against a machine. And it is kind of brutal that it takes a bit of time to actually run these on a virtual machine. There's other crazy solutions, advanced solutions, if you're into the Docker thing, that actually can significantly speed up Chef runs to the point where the only thing that actually ends up running is what you've changed versus everything over and over again. But one of kind of the key and core components of Chef is that it's idempotent, so that when you run a command to install something, it will only run once. The next time through, it'll realize, I've already run this on this machine, I don't need it to run again. So in this case, I can show you that because I've already pre-prepared the virtual machine I'm using, in this case, it will actually, since everything is already there and ready to go on this machine, this should just take a couple seconds to actually say, hey, I'm done, right? It's gonna go through and check that I've done everything that I said I was gonna do, and it's done, right? We waited all 5 seconds for it to check that all of the things I said I needed it to do, it did it. Had I destroyed the machine and started it up, it'd take about 5 minutes to compile, install everything, update the package manager, and things like that.
Do you have to build that into each recipe then to make sure that it knows how to check before it runs a command that would otherwise cause something to get to have side effects if it was run twice?
Kind of. So the idea in the Chef community is that they'll actually create what they call a bootstrap, which is the starting point that all of the servers, or what they call in their parlance is a node. All of the nodes in your environment should start off with a base of, say you're a Ruby shop, you're gonna install RVM maybe, or RBenv, and you're gonna install, you're gonna update the package manager, and you're gonna upgrade the distribution so that you're on the latest and greatest and have all of the OpenSSL latest and greatest upgrades. And you're gonna make sure that all of your developers' keys are on the machine so that when they need to SSH into production to make sure that things aren't on fire and production's okay. Those will all be part of what would generally be like a bootstrap recipe, that every time you start a new server, you'd run this bootstrap to set up all of these pieces.
Is the main term of this, and I missed it, is there a facility in Chef, like there's a Rails for migration, so if you already have a server that's had a fair amount of work already done on it, and you need to add new work to existing servers, and then new ones that you're spinning up, you need all the work done, that it's smart enough to just do the latter part of the recipe?
You know it is. It will act, like we talked about a minute ago, it will only run what it absolutely needs to in order to get the node to what they call converge, which is basically to a known state, to say, given all of the recipes I've told it I won't run on this node, all of those have been run. However, most people and the really big Chef people will tell you, you shouldn't actually take a node in a random state with like some stuff run on it and run Chef again to try and match it to a bunch of new nodes you've created. What you normally do, because our infrastructure is so repeatable and easily buildable, you would build brand new servers, throw the old one away, and never think back on it.
Nuke it.
Yeah, you just throw it away. The idea is like Kleenex architecture. When we're done with an existing server the way it's built, we create new ones and we start over.
That's new to me. I've never heard that. I'm writing this.
Kleenex architecture.
I like that a lot.
It's copyrighted.
So is there like enforceability for configuration drift? Like say somebody went in to that Learn Chef configuration file and changed it. The next time Chef runs, does it bring it back to the known state or
so the
what?
Trick is, because it's idempotent and it doesn't really have negative side effects, is if someone changes the recipe in a way that we didn't want, unless we change the recipe back, it will never go back the other direction. So if, like, say I went in here and just totally deleted this, what did I delete?
I don't mean in the recipe itself, but like say that file right there is supposed to be mode 755. What if I went into the server and chmoded it to something else? Does it go back and fix that?
It will, because at this point, the file exists, but it's not correct per the way I've described it, the way I've declared the file should be. It will fix that.
Okay.
So if you can do it recursively too. If the file's underneath it, if it was a directory, you need to be the same permissions, you could actually handle that as well.
So where does the, like, so this is, you set up the server, where does deploying your app into that?
So normally, most people in the Chef community would tell you that you don't actually use Chef to deploy your app. You'd use an already known solution like maybe Capistrano or Mina, or if you really want to, Shell Scripts. Or you just use something more similar to like just clone your source down. Once you provision a server to the point where, say it's a Ruby app and you know you need Rails and you know you need Sidekick and you need Redis and you need MySQL and all these different things, you'd use Chef to set up all these different components that your app is going to need, and then Capistrano would actually put your app on those servers. Absolutely, yes. This lives outside of an application. And the idea is that we don't necessarily want to tie cookbooks to a particular application that's kind of code smell, maybe. You'd want your cookbooks to be generic enough that when you build servers, it could handle different things. Like, say I'm building a Node app to serve as a front-end proxy to a bunch of other applications. I would set up a cookbook that does that. Not necessarily for the exact specific Node proxy code that I set up, but just in general, a Node server could run my application. Any other questions about what I've actually done at this point?
I wrote down a ton of questions, but I feel like you have more stuff to say, so I'm going to wait.
Not terribly too much, so go ahead.
No, go ahead.
All right. Thank you.
Let's get to your end, and then I'll inundate you.
Okay, so I didn't live code as much as I'd like to, but at that same time, I'd like it to actually work. So, so after seeing all of that, I know it's there was a lot to take in, and I probably didn't explain it as best as I could, but the reason I'm so excited about this and why I think it's really cool is that at the end of the day, it's all Ruby. I'm a Rubyist. I love Ruby. I love using it to accomplish the tasks that I do. So if I need to extend this, if I want to write my own cookbook to install Nginx from source, which I wouldn't want to, but if I decided that's what I was going to do, I could do it, and it's just Ruby. It uses the common patterns and syntax and things like that. If I want to test it, it uses RSpec syntax. And what we kind of touched on already at this point is there is a massive Chef community behind all of this. In addition to the fact that there's a Chef community, there's a bunch of cookbooks. So if you decide, I really just need to get stuff done, you can actually kind of borrow from the Chef community and use these other cookbooks to build up what we want to do. I could have written all of this by hand, but I'm kind of lazy as a programmer. I'd much rather borrow where I can and write only what I need to get the job done. So the community cookbooks are really awesome for that. Some of the resources that I used when I first started learning Chef, I put up on the screen. The first one is Chef's Own Guide on Learning Chef. Little side note, the company used to be named OpsCode. They recently changed their name, similar to the way Docker did, and similar to the way to some of the other companies. They've decided that their main product, Basecamp, right? They've decided that Chef is much easier to Google than OpsCode, so they definitely decided that was their company name, which it's not, it's terrible. the next resource that I use a lot is Joshua Timberman. He actually works for Chef, and he contributes massively to the community cookbooks. If you look at the community cookbooks, almost all of them he's touched at some point in time. He's contributed to, developed. He is an awesome resource. So the second link is his blog. He like writes a lot of very interesting things, and he's usually pretty up to date on what's happening, primarily because he works for Chef. The last link is the community provided cookbooks from Chef, even though it says OpsCode, they're from Chef, and there's probably hundreds, maybe even 1,000 at this point, of different cookbooks that you can use that are different platforms that will work to install all the different packages, platforms, services, things like that. The last two links I want to share with you are VirtualBox and Vagrant. VirtualBox drives all of the environment that I set up virtually so that I didn't have to actually install this on my MacBook. And Vagrant is the magical layer on top written in Ruby that allows me to declaratively describe my VMs and fire them up at will. It's for you, man.
Yeah! So, Chef Solo versus, what is the advantage of having a Chef server out there somewhere?
So Chef Solo is, hey, I want to set up my own personal laptop, or I only need to manage a single server, and I know that I don't really need to maintain state for my entire infrastructure. I just need to manage a single computer or a single node. Chef Server comes into play, and you can actually write values back to the Chef Server that other nodes can then query. So in one of my recipes, I could say, instead of hard coding like the database server's URL is 123.abc.company.com, I could then say, do a chef search, which means query the chef server for any nodes that are in a particular role, like the DB role, and then it would know to grab the URL for that particular server, so I don't have to hard code things. So it's a way to maintain state across an entire infrastructure versus, like, I've got it all on my laptop. The other really nice thing about a chef server is even when you're not running recipes, you can query the chef server. Say you need to know, how many nodes do we have in production right now that are app servers? So I can start asking the chef server and say, give me a list of all of the app servers you've got right now. Or tell me the host name of all of the different app servers. I can actually run some of these commands to give you guys a peek of what it actually would look like. Sorry, I guess I should have said something earlier. I made it way bigger. So at this point, we're going to actually use the knife command to start asking the chef server some questions. So if I want to know, all of the nodes that my chef server is managing, I can just tell it to tell me everybody. Give me a list of everybody, and this will give us all of the infrastructure that the chef is managing at this point. Let's say, you know what? That's kind of a crazy list. I don't really want to know all of them. So I could do a search and say.
Will you confirm or deny that knife stab is a command of some sort?
neither confirm nor deny, no.
Thank you.
Let's go back through my history here real quick and make sure okay, here we go. So then let's say we want to find all of our servers that are in the role of app, and we want to know their host names. So I can actually run commands across all of our servers and get the fully qualified domain name.
I just wanted to tell you that I'm a little bit terrified, knowing this is somewhat square DOS infrastructure.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's okay. only if it returns back an answer.
Let's connect to that knife stab.
I may or may not be causing alerts for whoever's on our exterminator right now.
This is how
I'm gonna out. I'm gonna cancel that one out. That may or may not be a good idea.
You don't even work there anymore.
So let's say instead I want to interrogate a particular. Let's
I
say
you just had your review today.
Let's say instead. Let's say in particular I want to interrogate a particular node, so I can actually ask the node information about itself and get information. Or I could say, you know what? Maybe. Here we go. Little non-production data. Here we go. So now I can start interrogating nodes and say, like, I want to know information about you. So I can figure out its IP address on the local network, some of the recipes I've added to this node, the platform that it's running on, and let's say I interrogate maybe the my production server, my database production server. And this will actually give me back some of the same information so that I can check certain things on it. And this one I will run a command on. Oh, no. Because I can't connect to it from... Oh. remember the exact command flag, but that would, if I put in fact authenticate as the correct user, that would show us the host name of that particular server. Did that kind of cover your question on the solo versus server?
Yes. Remind me what a recipe versus a cookbook is, which seems like I should totally know the answer to that question.
So a cookbook is a collection of recipes that do a particular thing or configure a particular service or install a particular package.
So a cookbook might be Nginx source, whereas a recipe would be, no, recipe would be Nginx source,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Cookbook would be this whole fucking server.
Yeah.
Right?
Not quite. That's a little too too far. Like, the cookbook would be Nginx. One of the recipes in the cookbook might be...
That's the Burke Show.
Yes. one of the recipes might be, like, say, package.
My kitchen doesn't even have a Burke Show. It has cupboards.
There are no cupboards in Chef.
Damn it, Chef.
You only get shelves by the Burke.
Okay, can I see a source for a recipe, maybe? Just for fun time?
Yes. So, let's... So one of the cookbooks that I've worked on as part of my daily job at Squaremouth, we've open sourced, so we can actually look at some real cookbook code.
Live streaming this.
So if we look at if some of you are familiar with RubyCast, it's a central authentication login system. Oh.
Mbiggin.
Is that big enough?
Mbiggin.
Mbiggin.
Yeah, thank you.
Mbiggin. So there's a lot more crazy stuff going on in here. And some people in this room, namely these two guys, have contributed to this cookbook as well.
So it's the loud things can talk.
So part of this is maybe setting up, it looks like right here, we're actually setting up a user on the server, and we're reading out what they call attributes, which is just the way we kind of store shared data across recipes about a particular node. And this at this point, we're setting up a group that's going to be the RVM group, and we're going to add users to it so that we can configure a particular user that our app is going to run under. Again, the template resource that we can use to render out a template. There's even some stuff to use Git to clone things, which this is kind of one of those code smells where you shouldn't be cloning apps, the source code of your app directly onto your server via Chef, but you can definitely do it.
So all of those methods with Git, template, user, group, all of those are just built into Chef?
Yes, all of these are what they call LWRP's, long-winded way of saying a way to get stuff done. Right? They have a lot of built-in stuff, and you can also add gems and or cookbooks that provide other ways of installing and configuring things. But the defaults, like creating a file, creating a template, using Git, installing packages, those are all built into the way Chef works right now. Looks like we're doing some crazy stuff in there. Should I scroll past that one?
Did you want to get blamed on that really quick?
We can, in fact. My name's all over this repository, so I don't think we want to do that. And so in this case, RubyCast has different pieces to more answer your question of what would be in a cookbook. Because there are different components in order to deploy a RubyCast server, we'd actually have a server recipe where we're actually like the app server. And then there's a Nginx recipe, which in fact sets up Nginx and compiles it from source, which is kind of where I got my template from. There's a default recipe, which in this case does nothing. This is something weird that a lot of people in the Chef community will do. Their default recipes won't do anything. I don't know why, just that's what they do. And then the last thing is...
What happens if you delete a default recipe?
Nothing. Well, no, not nothing. If somebody adds the shorthand of your cookbook, if they just put your cookbook in the run list and there's no default recipe, all hell breaks loose and they get a lot of nasty error messages. And then the last part is actually setting up, say, a database server where you're going to store all of your users. And the beautiful thing is that although this cookbook has maybe four recipes, you can actually deploy different pieces of this cookbook to different servers so that, you know, you follow the 12-factor way of doing things and you separate out your these pieces from those pieces. Like, you don't want your database running on the same as your app server, and you don't maybe necessarily want Nginx running on the same server as your app server itself. Maybe you have three different servers that kind of work in concerted effort to provide this resource.
How often do you end up creating custom recipes and or cookbooks?
So anytime it doesn't basically do what we want out of the box, like they give you a lot of Lego blocks, essentially. They give you big pieces of code that help you configure things. Most times when I want to install an application, I have to write code. It's not just like, oh, hey, wow, there's this new package. I'm just going to add this to my run list and away it goes. I usually have to maybe write some custom configuration because I want it installed in a particular way that maybe it doesn't handle. Like, maybe they don't set up an upstart script so that my app fires on launch of the VM or the cloud server or whatever. So most times I end up writing some kind of custom configuration, at least to get it to fit within my existing infrastructure. Yeah, the other thing is if there is a community cookbook that kind of does mostly what you want to do, you can write a bit of a wrapper around it that is kind of like maybe a plug-in to another, to a gem, maybe that kind of similar thing, where you can kind of, after it's run, go back and change a few things to make it do exactly what you need it to do.
Like monkey patching.
Shh, we don't call it that.
So, can you give us an idea of what SquareMouse, without revealing anything proprietary, what SquareMouse infrastructure looks like that is managed by Chef?
Everything. From our own personal laptops to all of the servers we create in our cloud infrastructure to even the servers in our closet in our office, everything is managed by Chef. Even our DNS in the office is managed by Chef, because the last thing we want to do is have some crazy incantations of shell scripts and command line stuff to set it all up. So we'd much rather be able to say, we really need this kind of server, let's just go and build it.
How many like app servers and DB servers are you running these days, if you know?
I know, but I really don't know if I'm supposed to.
Okay, that's fine. No problem.
Yeah. I can neither confirm nor deny that that actually happened.
He's gonna have to start building pretty soon.
Yeah, I know, right? Who here uses Chef already? Square
has,
right?
I use Chef.
We're using a little and we're using things at
Heroku.
Wait, does it involve hiring? Right?
No. But we are hiring DevOps engineers.
Just star engineers.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
I use the README with all the commands for the shell. Setup.md.
Anybody using something other than Heroku, Puppet, Chef? There are actually a bunch of others out there that I don't know much about.
I just started playing with Ansible.
Yes. I think there's a Salt or something.
Is this a SageCon?
Yes.
Bash? You made this thing called Bash?
What?
We use Docker to get the containers for that app, but it's not really configuration management.
Okay.
Well, you could think Docker is configuration management. You can set up an image, which is kind of like a recipe. And you can spin up containers based off of an image that are built the exact same way off of a recipe.
So worth mentioning, also Blueprint, which does this kind of thing, which I gave a talk on a while back, so it's on ndrb.org. But it can reverse engineer existing infrastructure to Chef or Puppet scripts, which is pretty cool.
Blueprint. Very interesting.
Pretty much everybody at SquareMouth just kind of share in this configuration, or are you guys kind of focused on it? I mean, I assume everybody obviously touches it a little bit, it seems like.
To some extent, yes. At this point, we have a particular person who focuses solely on DevOps, and then there's a couple of us in the office that kind of sharing the what we call chef love.
Hey, children.
So some people. There are some people in our office.
Fireplace.
There are some people in our office that are full stack developers. They go all the way from provisioning servers to writing Ruby to writing Rails apps to you name it, they do it, right? And then there are some people that focus primarily just on our main applications and our main business line.
We have a little bit of leisure to kind of focus on what we prefer to focus on, but if you wanted to be involved in everything, we could be involved in everything.
The only other thing that is very worth mentioning is I'm going to push, I haven't pushed this up to GitHub yet, but I'm going to, and you'll be able to clone this repo down if you want to test some of this stuff yourself. Although, before I push it up, I want to write a README so that it is very, very noob friendly to get all of the dependencies installed so that you're not like opening issue. Well, you know, before I even started, I might want to kill the issues, but very smart idea. But so that people can get up and running quickly and easily, how to set up the dependencies, how to install all the pieces, and then how to run some of the same commands that I did so that you guys can recreate what I've set up and kind of play around with it.
And knife things.
You touched on this a little bit, but where does Docker kind of fit into this? And maybe I saw the word Docker in the list there, but.
Let's go with WTF is Docker.
Okay. Docker is lovely. Docker is do you really want me to?
Yeah, for real.
I was actually going to ask you after this if I can come back next month and talk all about Docker.
Oh yeah, let's do that.
So hold your questions for a month. I'd very much like to come back and talk about Docker. Because that's my new love. I love it more than Jeff. No, it's basically all shell scripts.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
But, so next time we're going to talk about cappies.
Yeah.
I'm about to derail things. If anybody has more chef-related questions, you should totally ask those. Because I'm about to ask him how much we both love doing T-Mux. Yes. Much. No?
How much what?
Must be a little.
So is Vim and T-Mux and such like standard at Square Mouth? Because I think I'm going to sell fretless. I'm just joking. I'm not going anywhere.
It's like,
We hired Joseph. Yes. He opens two windows in T-Mux. This guy had four windows.
Well, it's only because I don't have the Square Mouth dot files anymore.
So to be clear, like I have a lot more going on.
Yes.
I have 10 different windows, and each of those windows has four panes. And I have probably 11 Vim sessions running at any given time. I am a heavy Vim Tmux. I actually use a couple layers on top of Tmux to make it even nicer. I use WeMux and Tmuxinator. So when I start my setup in the morning, it is one command and it sets up all of my Tmux. It sets up all of my Vim, all of my buffers.
Word, man. Just Mux. I just double click it.
You use your mouse?
Yes. shame, I know.
The other thing is I don't use my mouse at all. I hate mice. Unless I have some.
You know what? He didn't pay anything for that.
I didn't either, technically. Next year we're hiring him.
And for those of you who really love Vim.
Wait, you're double clicking on that.
This is a big deal. For those of you who really love Vim, I don't use a mouse in my browser normally either.
Which one is that?
Vimium.
What's the other one?
That's just Vim Creator or something?
Yeah.
Is that Command
App? it doesn't work on Google.
When you have a video and you want to pause it.
Why aren't you always Command Line
on the browser?
I do use links too.
I'm being an ass.
Yeah.
Links.
So the standard developer setup at Square Mouth is, in fact, Vim and Tmux and things like that, although we have the freedom to use whatever we want. When I first started, I was a Sublime text user, and then I saw the light. Sorry.
I have a last question, not related. Anybody have any favorite team max question?
How are your wrists? Are they all right?
You know, so they're not bad, but I actually, like, not even 3 months ago learned to touch type. I used to type with exactly 6 fingers.
Wow.
So, yeah, so now I actually touch type, so not bad yet.
And you're more or less flying around T-Mux and Vim, so it's been a lot of progress in a few months, right?
Yeah.
It's not Emacs, dude. Emacs is how you get carpal tunnel.
It's from having your wrists like this, your keyboard needs to be more like that. Or more like this,
so
Nat.
The trick is with Vim, is you have to remap your caps lock to control.
Yeah, yeah.
That's how you get stuff done.
Yeah, I do that too.
I agree. Will you be at Rebuild?
I will, yes.
Alright, you'll be at Rebuild? Who else is going to Rebuild?
I guess you should all go to Rebuild.
James, if I have the day off from work, will you actually pay me? But I pay for the conference, can I go to Rebuild?
Wow.
You're on the spot.
Hey, how's next year's hiring going?
We're going to Rails Conference.
I know I'm going to Rails Conference next week.
No, that's fine.
That's why I felt a little too deep in it.
Right.
Hey, Hannah,
I'm halfway asking.
Cool. I'll see you at Rebuilding.
Can we go to Rails Conference?
So I have to admit, I was terribly worried. This is the first time I've ever actually publicly spoke about any of the development or anything like that I've done. And I was deathly terrified that I was only going to have about 5 minutes worth of things to talk about. So thank you very much for all the questions you guys asked.
Nice
freaking
up, boy, down here.
No, that was really good.
A little bit.
I'm signing you up for Docker next month, too.
I only know a thing or two.
That's more than
we
I
have
need.
A month.
Yeah. All right.
Did we clap for Mac and
Evans? Did we clap?
I clap for Mac.